So good evening, everyone. Metabolic and nutritional diseases in sheep and goat. So here I have concentrated only regarding the clinical management and purely regarding the practical aspect, how to diagnose a case clinically and how to treat the case. So the normal vital parameters, most of the time when we are discussing with the veterinarians, when they are asking doubt, they used to say the temperature 104 and the animal is not taking feed and all. So the normal temperature varies between 103 to 104. That is a normal temperature in the adult sheep and goat. Okay, that is 39 to 40 degrees, a normal one. When it goes beyond the 40 degree, then only it is indicative of pyrexia. So that we have to keep it in mind. Then unless otherwise, the heart rate will be a prognostic indicator. So unless otherwise, in the small animals or the small, large animal, here there is no foreign body. Most of the foreign body syndrome and all is very rare. Here, the heart rate and all will be indicative of the prognostic indicator. It will give us a clue. For example, in acidosis case, when the heart rate is more than 100, that will giving a clue that the prognosis is very poor like that. So getting the vital signs is very, very important. And also in the neonates, seeing the heart rate and in acidosis case, so it's very important to see the heart rate. And the respiration rate, the normal respiration is 12 to 20 per minute. And the rumen motility is 1 to 2 per minute. So these are all the normal vital parameters in sheep and goat, the same as that of large animal cattle. And here the temperature alone, we have to keep it 103 to 104. The macro minerals, the involved in the metabolic process, the calcium, phosphorus, magnesium, potassium, sodium, chloride, and sulfate. The micro trace minerals, copper, cobalt, iron, manganese, zinc, iodine, and selenium. So each and every one plays an important role in the manifestation of clinical signs. For example, when copper is deficiency, that will manifest a clinical condition. When copper comes excess, that will manifest a clinical condition. That we have to identify just by seeing the clinical signs in our field practice, because we are going to attend the cases in the field level. Suppose if you are attending a flock, a very big farm, when there is a disease outbreak or when there is any abnormality, you can very well, so many standardized parameters and standardized literatures are there. In the backup, you can collect all the materials and you can authenticate it and you can diagnose very easily. And before that, you have to identify the clinical signs of the small ruminants. What is the abnormality in the animal? First, we have to learn how to identify the abnormal clinical signs in the small ruminants. That is the most important part. And all mammals, including goats, they synthesize vitamin C. Hence, there is no extra supplementation of vitamin C. So, but whenever the animal becomes a diseased condition, so rumen, when the animal is not taking feed, when the animal is under eating, in such a conditions, you can go for supplementation of vitamin C. Otherwise, there is no need. And B-complex is also synthesized in rumen and also by intestine in the bacteria. So that is also very important when there is when there is any sudden change in the feeding pattern. And the B-complex deficiency, the B1 deficiency, thiamine deficiency plays a very major role in the clinical condition like polyencephalomyelitis, that we will discuss here. And the other vitamins included is vitamin A, D, and E. Vitamin A, hypovitaminosis A, and vitamin E deficiency, and D. So just we will see what are all the clinical conditions which are exhibiting in the normal our practice. So regarding the metabolic conditions, so in large animal practice, in cattle, we would have seen the hypocalcemia, milk fever, ketosis, hypermagnesemia, fatty liver syndrome, low milk fat syndrome, postpartum hemoglobinuria. Like that, many things we have already known and we are doing in our practice. The same like that, the common conditions, unlike large animal practice, here the common conditions which are exhibiting is the hypocalcemia. So you can come across many number of cases of hypocalcemia. And pregnancy toxemia in farming conditions, very easily you can identify. Once you start identifying one or two cases, then you can identify very easily this type of pregnancy toxemia. Then hypomagnesemia to some extent. And diabetes mellitus. Diabetes mellitus also noticed in sheep, in goats, there have been some few cases are coming. In the nutritional deficiency cases, the nutritional, when it is excess, also manifests some clinical signs. When there is any deficiency also, it will manifest some clinical signs. Like that, when copper is deficient, it exhibits a condition called enzootic ataxia or Swaybank. Okay. Then vitamin E selenium deficiency, nutritional muscular dystrophy. Then polyencephalomyelitis, by vitamin B1 deficiency, thiamine. So these are all just when you identify the case, when you identify a PEM, polyencephalomyelitis, just a supplement thiamine, it will recover the case. So clinical, diagnosis, improving the skill of the diagnosis is most important. Then hypovitaminosis A, how to identify the hypovitaminosis. Then zinc responsive dermatosis. This all comes under nutritional deficiency. There are many other conditions. So when I include nutritional deficiency means each and everything what I have mentioned previously, all those things will have different type of manifestations and different type of clinical symptoms will be exhibited. But here, as a, this first webinar, as introduction, so when I give you everything in a 1 hour or 1.5 hour, it may not be possible for you to get all the points within a short period of time. So now today we'll be discussing what are all the things in the field conditions, day-to-day conditions. Then in future, we'll discuss in detail about the other conditions. And nutritional, I mean the excess. So nutritional deficiency means whenever there is deficiency, it will manifest some clinical condition. Nutritional excess means it's rumen lactic acid. It means sudden engorgement of carbohydrates, sudden engorgement with the carbohydrates, sudden change in feed with the carbohydrate. That will lead to rumen lactic acid. That is also comes under metabolic nutritional diseases. And enterotoxemia and copper toxicity. It's most unnoticed. It's very common in sheep and it's mostly misdiagnosed in when you come to this chapter, you will feel surprised that you would have seen many number of cases in sheep, particularly in sheep. It's not very common in goat. It is very common in sheep. Nowadays, that too, because many of them, they are rearing the sheep in the intensive form only with the more concentrate and adding mineral mixtures and other things that will lead to copper toxicity. And osteodystrophia, fibrosa, because of the excess amount of phosphorus in the diet. So these are the three classifications. One thing is the metabolic. Another thing, nutritional deficiency, and the third portion is the nutritional excess over. That means these three conditions we'll discuss in a short manner. So when we come to the hypocalcemia, it's very common notice in the sheep and also in goat. So in large animal practice, in cattle, in cow, the hypocalcemia will be exhibiting immediately after calving. So when animal calves, within 42 to 72 hours, we'll be getting more number of cases of hypocalcemia. That everyone knows. But in sheep, it is during the late pregnancy period. So many of the time, we'll be thinking the animal is not, recently not kidded, means we'll miss the diagnosis. So whenever the sheep is exhibiting the symptoms of hypocalcemia, I will tell the symptoms during the late pregnancy period, whenever the animal is going for recumbency, you have to think about hypocalcemia in sheep. And the calcium level will be very much reduced in the blood. And it is mainly due to the stress condition. When there is any stress condition, stress will aggravate the absorption of calcium and it will lead to hypocalcemia in the days of the last trimester of the pregnancy. And whenever the multiple fetus, the availability of calcium will be reduced. Whenever the inclement weather conditions, these are all the predisposing factors for hypocalcemia. So when the animal goes for reduced intake of feed or anorectic, naturally the calcium level will be reduced. And the animal will exhibit signs of hypocalcemia. And also reduced magnesium level in the serum. That is directly related to the secretion of parathyroid hormone and vitamin D. So magnesium, when that is ready, magnesium level is reduced. That will also trigger the cases of when the grasses or forages, they contain more oxalate. They will chelate or bind the calcium and they will bind the availability of calcium and the hypocalcemia will occur. Then regarding the clinical signs, the farmer will be saying, first the earliest clinical signs will be that the animal will be having staggering gait, mild staggering gait will be there, suddenly the animal will fell down, that is ataxia. And the nervous signs will be noticed in the early stage. Nervous signs means there is no tonic-clonic convulsions. Slightly the muscular tremors, and the animal will be slightly nervous symptoms will be noticed. The animal will be having incoordination, gait will be there. And hyperactivity in the early stages. But the animal in the early stages. In that time, you'll be noticing the muscle twitching of the lips and eyelids and ears. Frequently, twitching of the lips, eyelids and the ears. And later stage, the animal will go for the sternal recumbency. So the fasciculations should be noticed all over the body. And these type of symptoms, we cannot able to see. Only the farmer will be able to see. Suppose if you are in a farm condition, you can able to see. If If you are monitoring a farm, you can label this. Otherwise, the farmers will be noticing these type of symptoms, and later they will bring the animal to the hospital only after they become sterile recipients. So here we have to rule out whether the animal is having acidosis or not. In acidosis, the rumen will be having fluids passing sound. When you palpate the rumen, it will be having fluids passing sound. And in this later stages, the animal will go for a lateral recumbency in the final stages. So they will bring the animal in the sternal or lateral recumbency. The pupil will be dilated and urine is not voided. Dung is not voided. Sometimes the animal may be in the unconscious stage. They will bring the animal in the unconscious stage. See here, the animal is in the sternal recumbency. It is the unconscious stage. All the reflexes are reduced. Venous reflex is reduced and the nasal secretions will be there. And when we palpate the rumen is not having fluid passing sound. So acidosis is ruled out. Rumen is Duffy in nature. And here, when you see the rectum, the rectal mucosa is slightly relaxed. That is a clear thing which gives you a clue of hypercalcemia. So in acidosis and all, the animal will be having semi-solid dung material or watery dung material will be there. Here, the dung material will be solid in nature or pellety in nature or normal in consistency, and the dung material is retained in the rectum partially. So you can see in many number of most of the cases, the dung material will be retained in the rectum. The rectal mucosa, the rectal sphincter will be very much relaxed, and the urine is not voided. The animal will be in the comatose state. See, the rectal sphincter is slightly relaxed. You can very much appreciate the clinical signs. The animal is unconscious. When you see the pupil is dilated. So from the history also, you can say, you can ask, the animal is in full term pregnant, then you can make a diagnosis tentatively of hypocalcemia. See, the pupil is very much dilated. So what are all the other conditions which have people dilated? Enterotoxemia, the pupil will be dilated. Plant poisoning will be having pupil dilatation will be there. But in that and all, the animal won't go for comatose stage. The animal will be going for convulsion, severe convulsions, so that you can make it a difference from the other differential diagnosis. So our reflexes will be very much reduced. Okay, but the respiration will be there. The respiration pattern will be there, but animal will be like unconscious and reduced reflexes will be there. So the nasal secretions will be, nasal secretion and mild salivation will be there. So you identify it is a case of hypocalcemia and you can start giving calcium borogluconate, slow IV, and immediately the animal will respond to the calcium. The animal which is in the sternal recumbency or the lateral recumbency, immediately it will pass urine. The passage of urine, urination is the positive sign of response to the calcium. Even after giving calcium, if the animal is not urinating, it is not a case of hypocalcemia, then you have to reevaluate your diagnosis. It may be you have to verify whether it is acidosis or not. Okay, so it's very easy to diagnose. So after the treatment, after giving hypocalcemia, after treating with the calcium borogluconate, you can immediately the animal will respond and the animal will immediately stand and it will walk everything. The animal will pass urine and then will be passed and the animal will have start taking feed and all. And unlike cattle, here the one of the important point is the recurrence is most important. Immediately after 8 hours, within 8 hours, 6 to 8 hours, recurrence of hypercalcemia is more common. So we have to repeat the treatment whenever it is needed. So you have to go for subcutaneous calcium borogluconate administration or oral administration of calcium, I'll tell you. So this is after the recovery, after giving calcium, the animal urinated and it passed the tongue and the animal got up and it is normal. So you have to monitor, you have to tell the owner, see the shivering. See, in the early stages, it will be like that. So in the early stage of hypercalcemia, it will be same like tremors will be noticed and twitching of the lips will be noticed and the ear twitching will be noticed and the generalized muscle twitching also will be noticed. You verify whether the animal is in the full-term pregnancy or not. If it is full-term pregnant, you think about hypocalcemia. So keep it in mind, in sheep and goat, hypocalcemia occurs during the last trimester of pregnancy, that too in the last few weeks of pregnancy. That is a simple logic and clue which gives you for your better diagnosis. Okay. So calcium borogluconate, IV, half IV and half subcutaneous. If you are having doubt or if you are having a fear of giving calcium immediately, you may be in some doubt. So you can very well mix the calcium in normal saline mix with the normal NS and you can give IV safely and repeat it at 8 hours interval to avoid recurrence, and oral calcium syrup can be advised. And when you are giving oral calcium, don't advise the gel preparations, because the farmers, they will push the gel, squeeze the gel preparation, and it will get aspirated, and animal will get aspiration pneumonia, and it will be spoiled, and it will get collapsed. So avoid drenching the gel preparation. If you are using the gel preparation, the precautionary measures how to drenching should be carried out. And also avoid the oral calcium should not be given in unconscious animals. So I have seen some of without they will go to the some shop and they will get the calcium syrup and they will be drenching when there is any emergency. So don't give any oral calcium when the animal is unconscious. The unconscious animal should be treated with the parenteral calcium bromide. It should not be given orally. Only oral calcium should be given only when there is swallowing reflex is present. Otherwise, you should not go for. After the recovery, after the treatment, after the recovery, then you can for follow up, you can give the oral calcium. Either you can give it orally or you can put it in the drinking water. The differential diagnosis, pregnancy toxemia, it always coexists with hypocalcemia. It's very easy, unless otherwise, if you are having a urinary cyst, the next topic I will discuss with you, how to identify pregnancy toxemia and hypocalcemia. So whenever you are giving this treatment, you will be giving the combined treatment with DNS, DNS and calcium borogluconate, everything will be covered. And the other differential diagnosis, hypermagnesemia. And ruminal acidosis, it is very easy to identify the ruminal acidosis just by palpating the rumen, whether it is having fluid splashing sound or not. Then polyencephalomalacia, it's very easy to diagnose, first by see the clinical sign, by nystagmus and incoordination. The animal won't go for comatose stage, the animal will be active and alert. Here the animal will be in the comatose stage. In polyencephalomalacia, the animal won't go for the comatose stage, only the convulsions will be there, nystagmus will be there. And botulism, that will be getting confused. So in small ruminants, botulism and this one, the hypocalcemia will be a confusing one always. So botulism, the abdominal muscles, the abdominal secretion will be, you can able to appreciate it. And unlike cattle, the animal won't go for lateral recumbency. Here the animal will be only in the sternal recumbency and the salivation, profuse salivation will be there. So sternal recumbency with the profuse salivation and animals which are reared nearby the poultry farm area, you have to think about the differential diagnosis of botulism. And enterotoxemia, severe convulsions will be there. Severe convulsions with the pupillary dilatation, diarrhea will be there, and sudden death will be there. So these are the differential diagnosis. You have to keep it in mind before treating hypocalcemia. But very easy. Just by seeing the tongue and relaxed anal sphincters and the last trimester of pregnancy, you can very well treat the hypocalcemia. And when coming to the pregnancy toxemia, this is another one important condition which are going unnoticed many of the time in our practice. It is seen both in sheep and goat, and more common in sheep. And it's also called as a lambing sickness or twin lamb disease, pregnancy disease or ovine ketosis. It's mainly due to the low blood sugar. Okay, the glucose level in the blood will be very much reduced and there will be ketonuria. And it occurs during the last few weeks of pregnancy. So mainly here also the predisposing factor is either it's a cold or inclement weather conditions. The animal could be whenever the animal is a negative energy balance. For example, there will be rearing more number of animals, advanced pregnancy animal in a separate area, and the feeder space will be very much limited. They will be feeding some in a common place with more segregation, and some of the animals which cannot be assessed for the feed materials. So due to the overcrowding. So day to day, it will going. It will be having a negative energy balance, and some of the animals will be having twins or triples or multiple fetuses. So the energy availability for each and every fetus, they require around about 40 gram of glucose per day. If it is having two or three fetuses, the animal will be having more need of glucose. So if the animal is having reduced feed intake, naturally the availability of the glucose will be reduced. Whenever the availability of the glucose is reduced, the availability of energy for the fetus will be reduced, and it will be very much limited. So what will happen whenever there is reduced energy availability to the fetus, or whenever there is reduced low blood glucose level, what will happen in the body system? They will draw energy from the fat. They will mobilize the energy from the adipose tissue. The adipose tissue, the fat is mobilized, and the fat is mobilized and replaced as energy purpose. And here, and the energy which is the fat, they cannot cross the placenta. That is the important one. Only the glucose can cross the placenta and they will cater the need of the fetus. the fat which is degenerated from the adipose tissue, I mean, they are mobilized from the adipose tissue, they cannot cross the placenta and they do not provide energy for the fetus, developing the fetus. So naturally, it will lead to the accumulation of ketone bodies. So ketone body in the level, and it will start exhibiting the signs of pregnancy toxicity. Here, the most of the cases of pregnancy toxemia in sheep, they will exhibit in the twins or triplets. So you can ask the history whether the animal will be lambing twins or triplets in the previous thing. You have to keep it in mind about that, and you can keep your differential diagnosis of pregnancy toxemia. The early signs, the animal will be separated from the flock. When many number of animals are there, so sometimes in the organized form, they will be keeping the pregnant animals as a separate one. So there will be separation from the flock. Those animals will be separate from the flock and they will be isolated. They will stand alone and they won't mingle with others and they will stand still. So it will, even when you make the animal walk, it is reluctant to walk. And sometimes it will raise the head like that, opisthotonus. It will raise the head, that is opisthotonus. Stand still means when you make the animal walk or when you approach the animal will be always standing still. So whenever you approach a sheep, it will run immediately. So you can experience in the farm visit, when you go near the sheep, the normal sheep, they will run away. So this type of sheep, they will be stand still. And you have to, if it is such a thing, you have to think about whether there is any apparent blindness is there or not. And you have to think about the other conditions like pregnancy toxicity. Later stages, and here, the dung will be, the feces will be dry and scanty in nature. Muscle tremors will be noticed in some conditions. And after some clinical signs later, it will be exhibiting like convulsions. So it will start developing convulsions and the stargazing appearance will be there in some cases. And later will go for recumbency and the depression will be there. And there won't be any elevation in the temperature, pulse rate and the respiration rate. Everything, the vitals will be within the normal rate. Some cases they will be exhibiting like a chewing and teeth grinding, vigorous licking movements will be there. So in enterotoxemia also, you will be having similar type of clinical signs will be exhibited, chewing and vigorous licking and teeth grinding. So here, whenever the pregnant animal, a sheep, which is having a twins or triplets, if it is not taking feed, anorectic, going for sternal recumbency, sometimes it may go for lateral recumbency or a stargazing appearance, you think about pregnancy toxicity. So as we are discussing that because of the low blood glucose level, of course, it is due to low blood glucose level. But in later stages, when it is presented in a delayed presentation, when it is coming in advanced stage, you will be experiencing hyperglycemia, I will tell you, okay. So in the early stage only, you can able to see the low blood glucose level. So many of our friends, they used to discuss, they will ask a doubt, sir, I have seen the blood glucose level, it is normal. Or sometimes they will say it is elevated. Of course, in the delayed presentation or in the advanced pregnancy toxemia cases, the blood glucose level will be elevated because of the stress factor and because of the adrenal activation and because of the stress factor, glucose level will be increased. And ketonuria will be present. So ketone bodies will be present in the urine that you can very well identify with the urinalysis strip, and hyperglycemia in means of terminal stages. That will be a confusing one. So you need not confuse by seeing the hyperglycemia. Pregnancy toxemia in early stages, it will be having hypoglycemia. Later, it will be having normal glucose level or hyperglycemia will be there. And increased NIFA. NIFA means non-esterified fatty acids. And renal failure at last, the death may be due to the renal failure at last. See, why they, I'm telling that some of the cases, they won't respond to your treatment of pregnancy toxemia. That is due to the end stage because of the renal failure. Okay, because the ketone body level increases, the bicarbonate level in the blood decreases. There will be bicarbonate deficit will be there and the acidosis occurs. So when the bicarbonate level declines, the animal will go for comatose stage. That is the end stage of pregnancy. There's a clinical condition. So in such a conditions, it won't respond to the treatment. That you have to keep it in mind. Pregnancy toxemia, when it is presented earlier, it will be well and good. When it is presented in the middle stage or in the advanced stage, no treatment will be fruitful for pregnancy toxemia. That we have to keep it in mind. And the blood glucose level increase during the later stages due to the response of the adrenal glands. So the treatment, regarding the treatment, so glucose injections. So mostly we'll be more, all the times we'll be giving dextrose 20% and we'll be repeating the cases. I mean the D20 or D25 or D50 repeated treatments, and there is no need of repeated using of the hypertonic dextrose solutions. Just you give glucose solution. You can give a DNS or a D20 or D50, whatever may be available. Glucose solutions you can give. When there is no response, you need not repeat the glucose injections alone repeatedly. That you keep it in mind. And in some cases, you can give insulin also. If it is needed, 20 to 40 units, in alternate days, you can give intramuscular. And electrolyte therapy is most important. Electrolyte fluid therapy is the most important in the management of pregnancy toxemia. And if it is not responding to our medical management, you have to go for the induction of parturition. Okay. You have to go for the induction of parturition. And oral, after the recovery, for follow-up, you can give oral propylene glycol. It is available in many trade names in the market. You can use 100 ml 2 times a day with the electrolytes will be giving a very beneficial for the recovery. So most of the times the failure occurs when it is presented in the early stage, it will respond to the treatment. Again, it will go for the negative energy balance because of the not supplementation of propylene glycol. So if you are supplying orally propylene glycol 100 ml BID or TAD with the electrolytes, it will be more beneficial and the response to the treatment will be more effective. And the other supportive treatments, you can give oral calcium preparations and the potassium chloride preparations will be very much helpful. The animal is able to recover from the hypokalemia and the oral calcium increases the survivability of the animals. And the electrolyte solutions, you can also even drench with the stomach tube. You can put a small stomach tube, I will show the stomach tube. And you can put the small stomach tube and you can drench the electrolytes also. Or you can put it in a feeding bottle and you can give the electrolyte solutions orally also. Okay. Some literature says that a flunixin administration 2.5 milligram per kg body weight increases the survival rate of the dam and the lab. This is because of the unknown mechanism. Just for your point, tips you can tell me. So in our clinical practice, if you are having a urinalysis strip, it will be very much beneficial for identifying such a type of cases. So whenever the animals are passing urine, just you dip it and you can see they verify the ketone bodies, presence of ketone body. You can very well diagnose the case very easily. So urinalysis strip is very much useful for our clinical practice. See, you have to use this urinalysis strip and the arrow mark will be given. And according to that arrow mark, you have to keep it accordingly and directly to that related thing, whether it's a blood, protein, and glucose, ketone body. All these things are mentioned and you correlate with the color changes and you can make it as whether it is positive or negative. It's available everywhere. You can use it for your very easy diagnosis. For example, when the animal is having severe convulsion, pupil dilatation, and it is brought to you with the diarrhea and all, the tentative diagnosis will be enterotoxemia. Suddenly the animal collapse, two or three animal collapse. So you are doing the postmortem and all, or you are having the urine sample, just you dip it and most of the time you'll be exhibiting glucose in the urine that you can think about. Yeah, that gives you a clue of enterotoxemia. Like that, urinalysis will be very much helpful for our clinical diagnosis. This type of beta hydroxybutyrate strip is also available everywhere. It is available that you can very well use it in large animal practice also for identifying ketosis. And it is same thing can be used for identifying the ketonuria in small ruminants also. So especially for beta hydroxybutyrate alone, separate strips are available. You can see it in the milk in large animal, urine in large animal, I mean cow. The same thing can be used in the small ruminants also. Okay. These are all the small things we have to procure then and there. So small gadgets, we have to get it in our practice and keep it in our kit so that our diagnosis will be very much advanced. So that it will be very appreciable. Okay, so you can make it a diagnosis and it will be the clear cut diagnosis and treatment will be fruitful. So you need not get confused by seeing many clinical conditions. So in advanced cases, that you have to keep it in mind, in advanced cases, it won't respond to any type of paper. So that we have to enlighten the farmers or the donor, because in advanced cases, it won't not at all respond to the treatment. And if you are having an ultrasound, it will be very much useful for evaluating the fetus availability, viability, and also we can verify whether one or two fetuses are. Nowadays, ultrasound plays an important role in the pregnancy diagnosis of small ruminants. And then during the pregnancy, when animals are segregated in a farm, in the advanced pregnancy, you can diagnose, you can scan all the animals, and you can see which are all the animals having twins or triplets. You can separate them. and you can feed them separately, and you can manage them separately, and you can avoid the pregnancy toxicity. Avoid, you can prevent the pregnancy toxicity by proper management. So ultrasound evaluation plays an important role. And the induction of parturition by dexamethasone 20 milligram, you can give IM, or dinoprost 10 mg IM in case of advanced stages. Even if it is not responding, then you have to go for a cesarean. See, the pregnancy evaluation, ultrasound plays an important role in the management of these metabolic conditions. Here, the take-home points are: no response to treatment when sheep becomes recumbent. That we have to keep it in mind. Whenever the animal go for lateral recumbency, the pregnancy toxemia with the ketonuria, hyperglycemia, these are the poor prognostic signs. They won't respond to any type of dexo solution, any treatment. You give, provide electrolyte fluid therapy, and you terminate the pregnancy and see, okay? And the prevention, provide high energy diet in the last month of pregnancy. So most of the time, there'll be fattening will be more occur in the early time of the pregnancy. And during the last trimester, they will reduce the feed. That itself will lead to the negative energy balance. That type of management also some farmers they used to have. In the early stage, they used to give more amount of high energy diet. And in the last month of the pregnancy, they will reduce the feed. Naturally, the animal will go for negative energy balance. So you have to keep it in mind, all these things. There should not be any sudden change in feed. Sudden change in feed will reflect the management aspect in always in a farm, and that will lead to the metabolic disorders. So you should not change the feed, any feed suddenly. And avoid making the yields obese in the early pregnancy. That I told already, when you give more high energy diet in the early pregnancy period, the animal become very much obese, and the rumen filling will be reduced. In later pregnancy, naturally the intake will be much reduced. So naturally, the animal which is having two fetus or a triple fetus will go for pregnancy toxicity. These are more chances. Not all animals will go. These are the chances for going. Then avoid abrupt changes in the feed, and avoid stress in the late pregnancy. Any stress will lead to pregnancy toxemia. And provide proper nutrition in the late pregnancy. Segregate the animal, pregnant animal, and the same type of a feed till the animal delivers. And proper feeding space should be given. So you should not dump more number of animals in a small space. So when you feed the animal, many number of animals will be getting access to the feed. Few animals, they may not get access to the feed frequently, and within few days they will go for negative energy balance. These are all the causes. And separate thin ewes, you may be seeing a thin ewes, I mean a thin and emaciated animal in a farm. You should not mingle that animal with the other animals. You have to keep the animal separate and reared, and you have to extra caring and extra feeding should be given. Then only you can prevent this type of pregnancy stuff. So all these things, differential diagnosis, I'm telling interrelated: polyencephalomalacia, hypocalcemia, luminal acidosis, listeriosis. All these things are interrelated. All the metabolic diseases are interrelated. So some few clinical signs will be giving you a clue for narrowing the diagnosis. So in diabetes mellitus, same thing. So you are treating a case of a pregnancy toxemia. That is a recumbent or lateral recumbency. The animal is having two fetus or triple fetus like that. That is a separate entity. Here, irrespective of the pregnancy, the animal will be going on emaciated, but the animal won't go for comatose dysphagia. In diabetes, the animal won't go for comatose stage. The animal go for, it will be walking normally, it will be taking feed, everything, but inappetence will be there, emaciated, polyuria, polydipsia will be there, weight loss will be reported. When you get the urine sample, it will be showing positive for glucose, and ketonuria will be present. So when you take the blood from the peripheral, I mean the ear vein, and you put it, see, you have to have a glucometer like this. So glucometer is available in all the medical shops. It is easily available for access. And you can have this type of glucometer, and you can immediately, the strip is there. After inserting the strip and put your drop of blood, immediately it will show the blood glucose level, and you can assess the plan of the treatment. If it is having low glucose level, you can supplement glucose. If it is high, if it is showing high hyperglycemia, you can avoid supplementation of administration of D20 or D50. So it is very much useful for our field practice, either in the large animal, I mean in the cow, small ruminants, and also in the pet animal practice. In dogs, you can easily rule out the diabetes by using this glucometer. So it should be in our kit. Glucometer, like urinalysis strip, glucometer also should be in our kit for easy diagnosis. So the normal blood glucose level is 50 to 80 milligram per deciliter. And you can see the, by urine analysis, you can able to see the presence of ketone bodies, and glucose urea will be there. And the glucose level will be very much reduced in case of, elevated. So here it is elevated. So the normal blood glucose is 80, 50 to 80. So in pregnancy toxemia, the blood glucose level is reduced, and later it comes to the normal. In advanced stage, it will be hyperglycemia. Here, the blood glucose level will be elevated, positive for glucose in the urine and positive for ketone also. Okay. So you think about diabetes, and you can treat these type of cases with the insulin, 1 unit per kg body weight. Either you can give 2 times a day subcutaneous. Okay. Only the management. This many cases have been recorded in both. So you can use this glucometer, and you can use this insulin syringe, and insulin lenti is available. You can get it, and you can calculate the dose according to the body weight, and you can give. And hypomagnesemia, some cases you will be exhibiting, because of the low availability of the magnesium, they will exhibit hypomagnesemia because of reduced absorption of magnesium. When there is increase in the potassium and the calcium in the diet, naturally the animal go for hypomagnesemia. Okay. Suppose whenever you are having some case, some other, suppose for example, in pregnancy toxemia itself, when you are giving potassium chloride syrup, you should not give in excess. When you give more potassium, that will lead the reduced absorption of magnesium, and the animal will start showing signs of nervous sense. That is due to hypomagnesemia. And hypomagnesemia, as I already told, it can induce hypocalcemia. All these things are interrelated. So as a safer method, you can give calcium with magnesium preparations when you are giving. That will take care of all your clinical signs. So grasses which are having low magnesium level, that will also be a predisposing cause for hypomagnesemia. Here, the same things like that will be having stiffness, ataxia, and hyperexcitability. The pedaling will be there, and the extreme length stiffness will be there, and the convulsions will be triggered by the external stimuli. When you make the animal like this, when you make the external stimuli, immediately the animal will be having convulsions, and then that. And the stress conditions, transportation, these are the predisposing causes for this hypermagnesemic tetany. So you can use the combined treatment of the magnesium and the calcium preparations available, you know, that and all you can use very well safely. So before administering all these things, repeatedly I'm telling you, have to rule out acidosis. So first rule out acidosis, palpate the rumen and see whether there is any fluid passing sound is there or not. If there is no fluid passing sound, if the dung is normal in consistency, then you keep your diagnosis differential as hypocalcemia or hypomagnesemic tetany. In hypocalcemia, the tetany won't be there. The animal will be recumbent or lateral recumbency, comatose will say. In hypomagnesemia, convulsions will be there. These are all the difference. We can very easily identify these type of cases. Tetanus, very easily you can identify. All the limbs will be very much stiff, and the locked jaw will be there. So locked jaw, all the 4 limbs will be stiff, stiffness of all the 4 limbs, and the ears will be erected, and it cannot be able to bend the neck. So these are all the signs of tetanus. And polyencephalomyelitis, I will show the clinical signs. We can give the magnesium infusions, magnesium or calcium combined infusions can be given either IV and followed by subcutaneous. And oral magnesium oxide or magnesium sulfate can be used for preventing the recurrence. So this is all the regarding the metabolic. So the most common thing frequently you will be exposing the hypocalcemia in sheep. Okay, then pregnancy toxemia, when the animal is having twins or triplets, animal going for central recumbency or stargazing appearance, you think about pregnancy toxemia. And severe convulsions, you think about hypomagnesemia. So if you are having glucometer and all, you can very well easily. So according to the blood glucose level, you can decide your treatment. Very easy for your diagnosis. That's a separate chapter. Now we concentrate on the deficiency diseases. So many times the farmers are the, they will bring the kids neonates to you with a day old kid or a 1 week old kid that is not getting up, not drinking milk and all. So they'll be bringing like this. So you have to think about the multiple deficiencies. The multiplicity of the weak kid syndrome. They used to call as weak kid syndrome. Mainly the animal will be in comatose stage, a neonate, young ones, within 1 week of age because of the neonatal infection. Mostly because of the neonatal infection, we have to advise the farmers to cut the umbilical cord. After delivery, you have to cut the umbilical cord and cauterize with the povidone-iodine or tincture-iodine to prevent the neonatal sepsis, to prevent the joint ill. We have to cauterize the umbilical cord. So that will prevent the neonatal infection. And multiple etiology will lead to weak kids. Weak kids means the animal will be weak in nature, emaciated, it cannot able to stand. One of the main things is a colostrum deprived animal. So with the immediately after kidding or lambing, the neonates, they should receive the colostrum within 6 hours. If you are missing that first 6 hours, then naturally the animals will be going for weak kid syndrome. So colostrum deprived animals are more prone for weak kid syndrome. And debility, the animal will be having subnormal temperature, hypoglycemia, because of low energy, hypoglycemia, the animal will be having a low energy, that will be in the comatose stage or the lateral recumbency. When you make the animal stand, the animal will be having staggering gait, unable to bear weight. And vitamin A, vitamin E, and the selenium combined, all these deficiencies will be exhibited. So in such a type of weak kid syndrome, you cannot able to collect a particular sample and you cannot able to come to a conclusion, see whether the animal is having neonatal infection or not. If so, you give antibiotics amoxicillin for controlling the neonatal infection. Then you supplement vitamin A and vitamin E and B complex. And the colostrum deprived animals, it should be, I mean, orphaned kids should be managed accordingly with colostrum and all. Okay. So you manage, if the animal is having low energy level, you can supplement oral electrolyte solutions or parenteral glucose solutions can be given. So just 5 ml glucose solutions can be given, IV, 5 ml can be given. And the vitamin A 0.5 ml and the B complex and vitamin E selenium deficiency you can give, and you can manage the weak kid syndrome. Within few days, you can make up few number of deficiencies you can give, and you can manage the weak kid syndrome. Within few days, you can make up few number of cases. You can prevent the mortality. So colostrum feeding should be done within the proper time. Within 2 hours, we have to drench the colostrum. We have to make the animal assess for the colostrum. And the animal sometimes when they are going for a comatose stage, you think about rapid respiration will be there. You think about neonatal sepsis or neonatal infection and treat it accordingly. So we can supply flunixin will be very much helpful for treating the sepsis case, and antibiotics whenever it is needed, amoxicillin you can give, and flunixin in case of whenever you come across sepsis. And fluid therapy. Fluid therapy is a small kid, just 5 to 10 ml, take it in a syringe and you put a butterfly needle and you can give 5 ml of a DNS or ringer lactate solutions, IV, slow IV. And the electrolytes, if the animal is able to swallow or gagging reflex is present, then you can go for feeding bottle. With the feeding bottle, you can supply electrolyte supplementation. These are the small, small tips that can save these small kids, and you can save many number of animals. I've seen the farm practice. We have within 2 to 3 days of management of these big kids, many number of kids are being saved, and we can prevent the economic loss to the farmers. And the another one important condition is hypovitaminosis A. So here you have to differentiate from the other conditions. So here hypovitaminosis is the day old kid, same thing in the cough also, the day old kid, it is unable to stand. So after kidding or lambing, the kid is unable to stand. It will be always in the recumbent. When you make the animal stand, see the head is, some animals they will be having hydrocephalus like thing, and staggering gait. When you make the animal stand, it will be having staggering gait will be there. It cannot able to stand properly. And the classical sign is the rotation of head. The animal will be rotating the head like this. See, the animal will be rotating the head as a 360 degree like this. Rotation of the head will be there. That is due to the increase in the intracranial pressure, increase in the intracranial pressure, and the animal cannot able to maintain the posture, and it will have a typical rotation of the head, that too in the day old animal. Ataxia means when you make the animal standing posture, it won't stand and suddenly it will fall down, ataxia. Okay, these are all the classical clinical signs, and you can treat these type of cases very well with the vitamin A. Injections can be given 440 units per kg body weight intramuscular for 5 days or till recovery. A very good dramatic response will be noticed, and you can see this case. I think the video is not playing. I'll show you later. The typical rotation of the head will be there. Okay, that video is not playing. I'll show you later after this end of the webinar. I'll show the video because once you see it, you will be, I mean, this is after the treatment and this is before treatment. And the farmers, they will say, they will bring the animal with the history that first 1 week, it is normal. It is walking normally, drinking milk, everything. After 1 week or 10 days, suddenly it became recumbent and the nervous signs are noticed me. That is polio encephalomalacia. That is a separate condition. Hypovitaminosis A means from the day old itself, the animal is not able to walk, not able to stand, and the rotation of the head will be there. This is hypovitaminosis. That is how we have to differentiate. So hypovitaminosis A, you have to give only vitamin A that will recover. First few days or first 1 week, 10 days, the animal is normal. After only it is exhibiting nervous signs, it is a clear case of B1 deficiency. You supplement thiamine, the animal will become normal within 2 or 3 days. This is the after treatment. The animal can able to walk normally. So that is regarding the vitamin A deficiency. I'm not going in detail about the vitamin A deficiency, the other clinical conditions, and how to manage everything. That will be seen separate sessions. Here only the clinical management. So since the lack of time also, I'm going fast because I want to deliver few conditions also. Here another important condition is the polio encephalomalacia. It's a very commonly occurring in the field conditions. Very, very common in the field conditions. Wherever you are going and seeing the small ruminant practice, goat or sheep farm, there may be, I have seen many farms in outbreak. Some farms will be having 20 or 30 animals. 30 animals will be having this type of, so I mean, like infectious, it's not infectious disease, but it is a managemental problem. It is because of the nutritional one, nutritional imbalance. Okay, so what is otherwise called as cerebrocortical necrosis? It is called as cerebrocortical necrosis, otherwise called as goat polio. It occurs both in cattle, sheep and goat, heifers and all. It's due to thiamine deficiency. If it means B1 deficiency, thiamine deficiency, it is mainly due to the altered human microflora, that is excess feeding of carbohydrate and low rotation that causes the polio supplementation. What will happen when you are giving excess carbohydrate means sudden engorgement of carbohydrate that will lead to acidosis. That is another one. But here, excess amount of carbohydrate, the rumen is adapted to that carbohydrate. The rumen is adapted to that carbohydrate. And when you are feeding with the low roughage, when you are feeding that animal with the low roughage, naturally what will happen, in the rumen, there will be a bacteria, they will develop. The bacteria, bacillus thiaminolytics, one bacteria is there, they will proliferate. They will proliferate when there is low roughage and excess carbohydrate in the feeding pattern, that will lead to the proliferation of bacillus thiaminolytics in the rumen. And this bacteria, they will block the synthesis of thiamine. So they will block the synthesis of thiamine. Whenever there is a thiamine availability is very much reduced, the animal will go for nervous signs. So thiamine is essential for the neurological functions. When thiamine is going very much availability is reduced, the animal will start showing signs of polyencephalomalacia. I mean, nervous signs will be noticed. So that is the main etiology form. So how it occurs in the outbreak? So many times when we go for any treatment or when you go for any opinion or any treatment in a farm, they will say most of the animals, 10 or 15 animals showing nervous signs, naturally will be going for infectious origin. We have to identify the feed also. Sometimes a sudden change in the feed, low roughage availability, high carbohydrate, predisposes the vitamin B1 deficiency. Okay. And excess sulfur, whenever there is excess sulfur in the diet, that will also will block the absorption, that will inhibit the absorption of thiamine. When you are treating the animals for coccidiosis, for example, in a farm, you are treating a coccidiosis and you are giving amprolium. When you are giving amprolium in excess dosage, amprolium induced polyencephalomalacia occurs. That you have to keep it in mind. Sulfur also, amprolium, excess carbohydrate and low roughage. These are all the predisposing factors. And wet distillate grains used for the feeding the animals. And high molasses, urea diet associated, they will alter the thiamine status. These are all the causes or etiology for polyencephalomalacia. In household, small ruminants, sheep and goat, how it appears, the people, I mean the farmers, they'll be giving the animals the rice gruel or rice gruel water or waste kitchen like that. They used to give daily whenever the animal goes for grazing and come back in the evening. They used to give rice gruel lightly, but the rumen might have adapted and the availability of roughage will be very much reduced. Only they will be feeding carbohydrate, which naturally the animal will go for polyencephalomalacia like that. So here, you can able to see the movement of the eyeball. is the nystagmus. It's called as nystagmus. Either it may be exhibited as a vertical nystagmus or horizontal nystagmus. So it's the classical sign of polio encephalomalacia. Nystagmus will be there. All other vital signs will be normal. So in polio encephalomalacia, all other vital signs will be normal. Temperature will be normal, heart rate, respiration rate, everything will be normal. The animal will be having a feeding habit will be there. So earlier signs, the animal will be having staggering gait. The animal will be having staggering gait. Once you saw the animal, the hind limb is abducted. The hind limb is abducted and walking, started walking. You have to think about the early signs of polio encephalomalacia. When you give some plant materials or grass material or forages, the animal will take the feed. There won't be any reduction in appetite. There won't be any reduction in the appetite or anything. It will be taking feed and all. But when you make the animal walk, it will walk slowly and with the abducted leg and lowering of the head in the early stages. And there will be incoordination. The animal will be staggering gait and incoordination will be there. When you touch the animal, suddenly it will fall down. And then involuntary convulsions will be there. There is no tonic-clonic convulsions. There is involuntary pedaling-like convulsions. It is important point. You noted that involuntary pedaling-like convulsions will be noticed in polio encephalomalacia. And you can able to see the nystagmus. It is very much obvious. And it will give you a clue for diagnosis. See here. The nystagmus, very much obvious. So in all the animals, you have to see the mucous membrane and also the eyeball, whether it is fixed or moving eyeball. I mean, nystagmus is present or not, you have to. So when you give some plant material, the animal will be taking feed. When you make the animal stand, it will be having wide base stand and see the involuntary pedaling will be there. So another one important, one classical clinical examination is that when you place the animal to one side, the animal will turn back to the other side. That is the classical sign of polio encephalomalacia. See, here is another case. It is the general recumbency. But sometimes it may be looking like you may be differential diagnosis, anemia and all, you'll be thinking in your mind. But when you go close and you can see the movement of the eyeball. See, the movement of the eyeball is there. It's a classical sign of polio encephalomalacia due to vitamin B1 deficiency. Okay. So the rumen is deaf in nature, there is no diarrhea, no fluid passing sound, so acidosis is ruled out. See here also, it's another one case of polio encephalomalacia and the nystagmus is there. See here, the animal is in the lateral recumbency, pedaling is there, tongue consistency is normal. When you make the animal to rotate in another side, see, it is trying to get up in the other side. See, it's a classical sign of polio encephalomalacia. For example, if it is a case of intoxication or if it is a case of any other case, acidosis, if you make the animal rotate, I mean, if you make the animal put it on the other side, it will lie on the same other side itself. It won't try to get up. If it is trying to get up, it is a clear case of polio encephalomalacia. So you can go ahead with your diagnosis. You can treat it accordingly. See, the animal is in lateral recumbency. When you put the animal on the other side, it's trying to get up, that's all. Sometimes you may be noticing the animal is having bloat. That bloat is due to the lateral recumbency. When you make the animal sitting in the sternal recumbency, naturally the bloat will be getting relieved. So no need of giving any anti-bloat agents or any other treatment for a separate treatment for bloat and all. Okay. See, the animal is having opisthotonus, raised the head is there. And unable to bear weight. See, all the four limbs are not placed on the ground. You can able to see the limbs which are elevated from the ground. See the forelimb and hind limb, it is elevated. That indicates CNS involvement. Whenever there is a CNS involvement, the forelimb and hind limb will be just slightly elevated from the ground level. That will give you as the clue and for easy diagnosis. So nystagmus, this type of involuntary pedaling, convulsions, and when you turn back, you turn the animal to one side, it will get back to the same side. And vital signs are normal, feeding habit, everything normal. These are all the things which gives you a clue for polio encephalomalacia. You can treat it well with the thiamine, 10 milligrams per kg body weight. Either you can give IM or IV. Okay. So repeat it at a 6 hours interval. And since it is impractical for doing it a 6 hours interval, you can even go for up to 40 milligrams per kg body weight and you can give IM or IV. Don't give any B complex injection, direct IV. That will lead to anaphylaxis and the anaphylactic shock will be there. So always mix it with the normal saline, give IV. Okay. So don't give any liver extract preparations IV. So that will lead to anaphylaxis. So use your thiamine preparation. If you are giving IV, mix it with the NS and give slow IV, or you can give intramuscular injection. Don't give liver extract any liver extract preparations intramuscular. And in some needy cases, we'll be giving 20% dextrose. And steroids, when it is a delayed case, then it will be going for dexamethasone. And mannitol, so you can give 1 to 2 ml per kg body weight in whenever it is a needed case. Here, the response to the treatment is very good when it is presented earlier. If it is a delayed case, if it is presented 1 week later, after the onset of symptoms, they are bringing the animal to you. After 1 week or 10 days, the response will be very much poor. It won't respond to the treatment because the name itself is the cerebrocortical necrosis. Irreversible brain damage will lead to the permanent lateral ligaments. The animal won't respond. Earlier presentation, the response will be very much drastic. Very good improvement will be noticed. So differential diagnosis, you'll be seeing cerebrospinal pneumothoriasis, Kumri. In Kumri, the hind limb paralysis will be most predominant, and the other signs will not be present. Only the hind limb paralysis will be there. Then it will very much respond to treatment with ivermectin. Then sclerosis, the animal will be dull and depressed, and that is due to the presence of the tapeworm. I mean, that you can differentiate. And the listeriosis, that I'll show some of the videos. In listeriosis, the animal will be having circling movement, and facial paralysis will be there. Here, there is no facial paralysis. See? The menace reflex is absent in one side, and they see the ear, it is drooping. The droopiness of the ear is there. Menace reflex is absent. The lips are partially opened. There is no proper closure of the lips. The lips are partially opened. And one side, the ptosis is there. Menace reflex is absent. Droopiness of the ears is there. The animal may be having circling movement. These are all the signs of classical signs of listeriosis. So you have to differentiate pollen encephalomalacia and listeriosis. Here you have to supplement penicillin. Or streptopenicillin and penicillin can be given with time in supplementations can be given. See, menace reflex is absent, and the fodder is retained in the oral cavity itself. The ear is droopiness is that when you give some fodder, the fodder will be retained in the oral cavities. Otherwise, the animal will be chewing. Cut dropping will be noticed. Otherwise, the animal will be keeping the fodder material in the oral cavity itself. These are all the signs of listeriosis. The same thing you can see in large animal also, cattle also. Okay, so you cannot miss the case of polyencephalomalacia, and you can very well treat it with thiamine alone. Okay. And here is another one case. You could have come across this type of cases. A lamb, some 3 months old or 2 to 3 months old, like that. It is exhibited the symptoms like that, frequent jerking of the hind limb. So you could have come across these type of cases in your field conditions. Other feeding habit, everything will be normal. All vital signs will be normal. So if you are seeing such a type of case in dog, what will be your diagnosis? Naturally, you will be thinking canine distemper in dog. The same hind limb, I mean the progressive paralysis is nothing but enzootic ataxia. It is due to copper deficiency. So two forms are there in kids. That's one thing is a congenital form and another is an acquired form. A congenital form means it is presented at the birth itself, at the day old itself. As I told, day old animal unable to walk, unable to stand, unable to maintain the posture means you will be treating with vitamin A. Even after treatment with vitamin A, if it is not responding to a treatment, you have to think about the congenital form of enzootic ataxia. Simple logic. Okay. And the second is the acquired one. The animal will be, the lamb will be normal up to 1 or 2 months or 3 months. It will be normal. Everything, they are walking, everything will be normal. After that, the animal will start exhibiting this type of symptoms. This type of things is due to copper deficiency. It occurs due to when there is rapid weight gaining. Whenever the animal is gaining the weight rapidly, because of the non-availability of the copper, naturally the animal will go for copper deficiency. I mean, the availability will very much reduce. Because of the demyelination of the nervous tissues, they will go for jerking like things. I mean, progressive paralysis will be noticed. See, copper is poorly absorbed from the fresh forage. So grazing and browsing animals are at the risk of copper deficiency. And copper is more available from grains and hay. That we have to keep it in mind. In grains and hay, copper is more available. And whenever there is high level of molybdenum and sulfur in the diet, naturally, sometimes molybdenum level or sulfur level can interfere in the availability of copper. See, you can keep this point more it will reflect in another one place. See, high level of molybdenum. How molybdenum and sulfur naturally? I don't know. Some without our knowledge, then whenever there is a dietary sources, when the molybdenum level is high or sulfur content is high, naturally the copper will be very much reduced. Previously, we have seen sulfur. Sulfur availability may also lead to the availability, will reduce the availability of vitamin B1. Polyencephalomalacia also will occur. So these are interrelated. So the animals, these animals very much responds to the copper, oral supplementation of copper, orally. You can supplement orally copper 20 to 30 milligrams per animal per day for 1 to 2 weeks or 3 weeks. Slowly the animal will get recovered. The copper glycinate injections are available in the market that you can use during the time of pregnancy to avoid this type of enzootic ataxia or sway back conditions. And you can supplement the copper orally, 35 milligrams per lamb, and you can use it as a prevention also. Okay. So the ordinary copper sulfate tablet, it is available in the dispensaries, that also you can use. And you can make it as a 20 milligram in a small portion, and you can give it to the animals daily. 2 to 3 weeks of treatment will respond. See, progressive paralysis and paralysis. Later, the animal will go for recumbency and it cannot able to walk. So this is nothing but due to copper deficiency, enzootic ataxia, splenda. And sometimes you may be coming across this type of animals. They will be bringing this type of kids to you, and the animal will be cannot able to stand properly, and the lowering of the head will be there. See, the typical, the neck muscle weakness will be there, lowering of the head will be there. So in cat, you might have seen in cat, when that is lowering of the head and coming very lethargic walking, means naturally will be suspecting hypokalemia in cat. Here, the newborn lamb with the lowering of the head, and all other things will be, the animal will be walking very slowly, very, very slowly. And it is nothing but nutritional muscular dystrophy. That is due to vitamin E selenium deficiency. So you have to supplement vitamin E injections daily till the animal recovers. Okay. So this type of animals you may be seeing in farm conditions. Just by seeing the posture and the walking, you can able to identify it is due to nutritional muscular dystrophy. Let me have a video later. And this is due to the a zinc responsive dermatosis. Sometimes some sheep and goat will be having crust like lesions around the eyes. Eyelids will be there, and also in the mucocutaneous junction and in the hoof, there will be crust like lesions will be there. The differential diagnosis you have to think about the dermatophyllosis and dermatophytosis and zinc responsive dermatosis. See, crust like lesions will be noticed. And this type of, after ruling out from dermatophyllosis or dermatophytosis, and it will respond very well to zinc supplementation. Orally, you can supply zinc oxide daily. So these are zinc responsive dermatosis. The ear margin also you can able to see. All the ear margins, crust-like lesions will be noticed. Zinc responsive dermatosis. Then nutritional diseases. So here, just I will enlighten. I'm not going in detail about the ruminal acidosis. Just I will explain about the conditions. Here the nutritional excess. Previously we have seen nutritional deficiency diseases. Here nutritional excess. When you give excess more carbohydrate, sudden engorgement of carbohydrate lead to acidosis. When the overeating leads to, during the grazing, overeating disease, the animal will lead to suddenly occurrence of enterotoxemia, ET. Osteo dystrophia fibrosa due to excess phosphorus in the diet and copper toxicity in sheep. These are the four clinical conditions which commonly occurs in the field conditions in our day-to-day practice. So just I keep it in mind. I will tell you the highlight alone. In ruminal acidosis, we are seeing as a mild, moderate, and severe cases. Mild cases, the animal will be walking normally, and there won't be any staggering gait, incoordination, everything, nothing will be there. The animal walks normally, but the animal will be passing semi-solid dung. So in sheep and goat, the normal dung consistency, conical shape. If the animal is passing like a cow dung, like that is indication of diarrhea. So you need not expect a watery dung in sheep and goats. So when the animal is passing semi-solid dung, it is indicative of diarrhea. So semi-solid dung with inhibitions to anorexia, fluid splashing sound in the rumen, it is a clear case of ruminal acidosis. When it is moderate, when the intensity is more, the animal is exhibiting staggering gait. Staggering gait will be there, heart rate will be elevated, the animal will be dull and depressed, and the animal will go for recumbency. In severe cases, they will bring the animal into lateral recumbency in the coma state, comatose state. So they are acute acidosis, severe acidosis. You know, acidosis occurs, ruminal acidosis occurs due to the sudden engorgement of carbohydrate. So many of the farmers, they used to say, we are giving carbohydrate for a long period, there won't be any problem. Once the rumen is adopted, there won't be any issue. Sudden feeding, excess engorgement of carbohydrate suddenly means that will lead to the accumulation of lactic acid in the rumen, that will lead to ruminal acidosis. I'm not going into the pathophysiology. So sudden ingestion of toxic dose of carbohydrate, I mean the excess amount of carbohydrate, will lead to the rapid multiplication of these streptococci bovis. One bacteria is there, they will start utilizing this type of carbohydrate, and they will, the end product is the rumen, the lactic acid. Once lactic acid is accumulated, the rumen pH will be very much reduced. The normal pH is 6.7. So when the pH goes below 5 or below 4 and all, according to the pH level, we can term it as mild, moderate and severe. If it is very much less than 4 and all, means 5, it is a acute lactic acidosis. According to the intensity, you can term it. And because of the accumulation of lactic acid, the animal will go for staggering gait, incoordination, and fluid passing sound will be there. So the animal will be exhibited with you to the hospital. And once you diagnose it, you can remove the rumen content. You can evacuate the rumen content by using this type of stomach tube. Some video problems. So video is not able to play. I'll show later. See, the rumen content will be milky white in nature. The rumen content is milky white in nature, and the pH will be very much reduced, I mean acidic in nature. And when you put a drop of rumen liquor in a microscope and see, there won't be any protozoa. Just by seeing the rumen liquor, you can say it is a case of acidosis. The sour water will be there, milky white in nature. So the first and the foremost line of treatment is the draining of the rumen liquor by putting the stomach tube. Put the stomach tube and remove the content. See, this type of diarrhea will be noticed. And this type of stomach tubes can be used. See, this type of stomach tube are available everywhere. And you can use this type of stomach tube and evacuate the rumen content. That is the first line of treatment. And this type of stomach tube is also can be used. It is used for the gasoliter and all, or this type of hose pipe, small tubes. You can use it as a stomach tube. See, this type of tube is also available. And this is available from the gastric lavage tube, available for the human being. That is available, that can also be used. Just you can use it and you can remove the rumen content. Whichever is affordable for you, you can get it. And for learners, this type of mouth gag are available. Just you can put the mouth gag and you can start putting the stomach tube for a few cases. And once you got experience, then without the mouth gag, you can start putting the stomach tube and you can evacuate the rumen content. The first and the line mode, foremost treatment is the evacuation of the rumen content. Then you go for the treatment. See, this type of rumen content should be evacuated. Then only it will respond to the treatment. And you can give oral antacids like magnesium carbonate, magnesium hydroxide, and aluminium hydroxide combinations. Commercial preparations are there, like Bruce's syrup, Gelusil, Bubsone, Tumibub. Many things are available that you can use as antacids, as oral antacids. And the first line of treatment is evacuate the rumen content, and you can give sodium bicarbonate with normal saline. So whenever you are giving sodium bicarbonate, take care that you should not rapidly infuse the sodium bicarbonate rapidly. That will lead to rapid alkalinization and the animal will go for shock. Take care. So always better is that you can mix it with the normal saline, give IVR, you give very slowly. Since the body weight is very much less, you give very slowly. And the other line of treatment includes antihistamines. You have to supplement the B complex. And once it is recovered, then only you have to go for the other things, the probiotics and cut transplantation. So why I am telling, most of the practitioners, they are going for cut transplantation the day of their presentation itself. First, you remove the rumen content with the stomach tube. Then you give sodium bicarbonate in the normal in NS. Don't give DNS. Some of you are giving DNS. That should not be given. Dextrose also should not be given. DNS or dextrose solution or D20, that should not be used. Sodium bicarbonate with the normal saline, that should be. Some questions will be there, whether we can use Ringer lactate or not. Ringer lactate is used as a fluid therapy. Okay, here you are using the bicarbonate for the bicarbonate deficient. After treating with the bicarbonate in normal saline, you can give Ringer lactate for follow-up or as a fluid therapy. For correcting the dehydration, you can use electrolyte solutions. But you never use DNS or dextrose solutions in case of acidosis. And you can use B-complex injections and antihistamines can be given. And oral antibiotics can be given, and oral antacids, like as I already told, that can be used. Then for follow-up, you can use probiotics and contransplantation. What is contransplantation? That is for follow-up. I mean, once you treated, the animal recovered, but the animal is not taking feed, you can go for cut transplant. I mean, rumen cut transplantation. I mean, transponation or cut transplantation. Collecting the rumen liquor from the healthy animal and giving to the affected one. For small ruminants, you can give 500 ml to 1 liter or 1 to 2 liters. This is a very big sheep or a very big body weight goat. Even you can go for 1 to 2 liters you can give. Or you can drench 500 ml to 1 liter you can drench. Collect the rumen liquor, fresh rumen liquor, and you can drench. Okay. And all these, in another one session, in future session, we'll be dealing with exclusively of rumen acidosis, because each and every clinical sign is very important, and how to approach the various stages and how to approach a different type of clinical conditions of acidosis, that will be seen in future classes. And the what we are using, the thing is the thumb rule. It is derived from the formula of 0.3 into base deficit into body weight. That gives the milliequivalent of sodium bicarbonate. So we are having the sodium bicarbonate preparations, commercial preparation as 7.5% sodium bicarbonate preparation is available. That 1 ml contains 0.9 milliequivalent. For approximately 1 ml is equal to 1 milliequivalent available in the market. That is 7.5% sodium bicarbonate. 1 ml contains 1 milliequivalent of sodium bicarbonate. So you calculate accordingly. 0.3 into base deficit, that we used to say as mild, moderate, and severe. According to the base deficit will be 5, 10, 15. That will be seeing in next webinar, so that you can understand well. Just for your awareness, I'm telling this formula. So after deriving that, you can, the thumb rule is 1 ml per kg body. For mild cases, mild and moderate cases, 1 ml per kg body weight. And the severe ruminal acidosis, 2 to 3 ml per kg body weight. Mix it with normal saline, give intravenously. For correcting DNA, dehydration, you can go for a normal saline, or regular lactate solutions can be given. Don't use DNS or dexo solutions. So once a dehydration is corrected, the simple logic in the success of the treatment is evacuating the rumen content, correcting the bicarbonate deficit, correcting the dehydration. Once you correct the dehydration, the success of rumen acidosis is more. Okay, you can effectively create the success of more number of cases. And whenever the animal is bringing to you with the lateral recumbency, acute ruminal acidosis, pupil is very much dilated, heart rate is more than 100. You have to tell the prognosis before starting the treatment. Once before starting the treatment, you have to tell the prognosis. Once, otherwise, what will happen? When you connect the fluids and you are giving the sodium bicarbonate, within few minutes, the animal will die. So they will be telling the animal consumed the rice yesterday evening. From yesterday evening to till evening, it was in the lateral recumbency, the comatose state. That means acute lactic acidosis without treatment. Once you started the treatment, the animal died. Then it will be thinking that this is due to the faulty tube. It's not like that, because of the acute ruminal acidosis. When the pupil is dilated, when the animal is in the comatose stage, acute ruminal acidosis, you have to tell the prognosis and then start the treatment accordingly. Then the other condition is osteodystrophia fibrosa. So you might have come across some cases. There will be bilateral symmetrical enlargement of the face and jaws. Some goat, it will be having protrusion of the tongue like this. See, the jaws is all the bilateral jaw will be like this, like a triangle shape. And the animal cannot be able to close the mouth properly. And the tongue will be always protruded. Okay. So you have to differentiate from listeriosis and all. So in listeriosis, sudden onset will be there. Here, progressive onset will be there. And swelling of the joints will be there. All the forelimbs and all the joints will be prominently swelling. Prominent eyeballs will be there. And the limb deformities will be there. And the hind limb is bent outward symmetrically from the tarsal joint. So these are all the things which gives you a clue of osteodystrophia fibrosa. So in listeriosis and all, there won't be any limb deformity. There won't be any swelling of the joints. Everything will be normal. So here, all the other clinical signs will be giving you the associated clue for diagnosing osteodystrophia fibrosa. See, here the tongue will, the oral cavity is opened fully. In listeriosis, it will be partially open. The protrusion of the tongue is there. The jaws, the narrowing of the jaws, it cannot be able to chew the fodder properly. Okay, these are all the signs of osteodystrophia fibrosa because of excess feeding of phosphorus in the diet. So the they will be feeding more amount of bran in the diet. The bran which contains more phosphorus, that will lead to the excess amount of phosphorus and reduced availability of the calcium, that leads to the condition osteodystrophy fibrosa. Okay. So there will be low calcium level in the serum, high phosphorus level, and elevated serum alkaline phosphate will be there. So when you come across any type of in the farm condition, when you come across many number of cases, naturally you can go for a serum evaluation of calcium, phosphorus, and serum alkaline phosphatase, so that you can narrow and you can pinpoint the diagnosis and you can advise the management. So once it occurred, that treating the affected animal is not a fruitful one. Avoid, you can prevent the other animals from these conditions and avoid excess feeding of phosphorus, and you can give oral calcium with the vitamin D supplementations. Okay. So this is regarding the phosphorus, excess phosphorus feeding of osteodystrophy fibrosa. And the next, the last thing is this copper toxicity. So you could have come across this type of cases in the field conditions. So naturally, those who are attending this webinar, naturally, when you are coming across this type of cases, like whenever you are coming across a case of hemoglobinuria, first differential diagnosis will be babesiosis. Very good. You are diagnosed with babesiosis. But when you are giving treating for babesiosis with the diaminosine acetate, these type of clinical conditions won't improve. The animal will be going down condition and the mortality will be more. For example, I'm telling, one farm was there. There was an outbreak of hemoglobinuria. And all animals exhibiting signs of hemoglobinuria and yellow color mucous membrane, exhibiting signs of ichthyic mucous membrane. Yellowish tinge, ichthyic mucous membrane, coffee colored urine, and anorectic there. One by one, the animal is dying. Naturally, you'll be thinking about babesiosis. And but when you are treating with the baby for babesiosis with the diaminosine acetate, the animal should recover immediately. Within 1 or 2 days, the animal should recover. Irrespective of the treatment, if it is not recovering, you have to think about copper toxicity. It's more common in sheep. Okay. It's due to excess administration of copper. That is the primary etiology, is excess administration of copper. And another thing is the accidental ingestion. That is few cases only. Mostly nowadays, many of the farming conditions, they are making the intensive farm and they are rearing the animal mostly with the concentrate alone. And they are giving very little quantity of the roughages, and they're rearing the animals for fattening. So because of sometimes they will be using the cattle feed, and sometimes they will be giving, whenever there is a feed contains excess copper or grazing materials or fodder materials which contains excess copper content also, there will be slow accumulation of copper will be deposited in the liver, that will lead to the copper toxicity. And the low level of molybdenum and sulfate in the diet, that will lead to secondary, it is a conditioning factor. So whenever molybdenum or sulfate is present excess in the diet, they will inhibit the absorption of the, they will enhances the low level of molybdenum. For example, molybdenum when it is excess means they will control the copper. So the treatment itself will be giving molybdenum. So when the diet contains low molybdenum or low sulfate, naturally the absorption of copper will be more, lead to toxicity. So what are all the sources of copper? Copper feed, the salts, pesticides, poultry litter, animals which are grazing near the poultry litter and the poultry litter area, grasses and all, and other high copper substances and the phytogenous, some of the phytogenous substances which contains more copper. These are all the causes for copper toxicity. Then why a sheep is more susceptible rather than goat? In goat is very, very rare. Only the sheep are more commonly affected because the liver cells of sheep have high affinity for copper. They excrete copper into the bile in a very low rate, leading to the high liver copper concentration. That's why you are getting copper toxicity more common in sheep. And in acute cases, anorexia will be there, abdominal pain will be there, then will be having hemoglobinuria and hemolysis and shock will be there. Once hemoglobinuria developed and the ichthyic mucous membrane is developed, you cannot save the affected animal. That is most important. In copper toxicity, it is very difficult to save the animal by treatment. You can prevent the other animals. You can prevent the toxic symptoms of the other animals. For example, a sheep farm, some 100 animals is there. Some 10 animals are exhibiting symptoms of coffee colored urine and all, and ichthyic mucous membrane, and you have diagnosed as a copper toxicity. You can prevent the other 90 animals from the mortality, rather than treating these animals. So mostly we can treat it also, but the response will be very much poor. So in chronic cases, the animals will be dull and depressed, respiratory distress will be there, and that mucosal membrane will become pale to ethic in nature, and hemoglobinuria occurs. Once hemoglobinuria occurs, that indicates it is a advanced stage of copper toxicity. See, the coffee colored urine is very much obvious like this. The animal will be passing urine like this in the farm. And one each and every one will be having respiratory distress will be there, severe respiratory distress will be there. The mucous membrane will become ictric in nature. This photo was provided by one of our friend, Dr. Sivanathan, we both attended a case in a farm. See the ictric mucous membrane in the oral cavity and the conjunctival mucous membrane. So whenever you are seeing the conjunctival mucous membrane, you have to see the sclera. The sclera will give the clear indication, the early stage itself. You can able to appreciate the yellowish tinge in the sclera. So in a sheep farm, animals which are having a coffee-colored urine, ictric mucous membrane, not responding to your treatment for baby cells, you think about copper toxicity. Okay. And the kidneys and all is a typical gunmetal colored appearance will be noticed in the kidney. And sudden death with the hemoglobinuria is indicative of copper toxicity in sheep. And treatment, symptomatic treatment only, there is no the response to the treatment will be very much poor. Only in the early signs the treatment can be tried. Advanced stages the treatment cannot be fruitful. And you can use penicillinamine 50 mg per kg body weight orally for 6 days. You can try it, or you can give calcium versanate to enhance copper excretions. So many commercial preparations are available. Human preparations are available. You can use that preparations. And ammonium tetrathiomolybdate, you can use it 1.7 mg per kg body weight IV in alternate days, or once in 3 days, or once in twice a week. You can use it for 2 to 3 occasions. So that will enhance the excretion of copper. And the intravenous administration of thiomolybdate can be used as a prevention and also treating the chronic cases of copper poisoning at the rate of 100 milligram twice a week. So that can also be a trial. Why I'm telling all these things? Once it has occurred in a very big farm, we have to manage it accordingly after detailed investigations. So ammonium molybdate, 100 milligram plus sodium thiosulfate. What we are using, the sodium thiosulfate for a cyanide toxicity, that you can use 1 gram daily for 3 weeks orally. That can be used as a preventive also. Sodium thiosulfate with ammonium molybdate can be used for 3 weeks orally. And dietary supplementation with the zinc acetate. Any one of the things, you need not go for all these treatments, whichever is feasible for you, whichever is comfortable and affordable for you, you can use all these things and you can prevent and you can save many number of animals. And with this, I'll conclude these things. And the high risk flock is, in the high risk flock, you can go for sodium thiosulfate orally, will prevent the copper toxicosis. Okay. And avoid the another important I want to emphasize here is avoid over supplementation with the cattle mineral mixture. So I've seen many of the farms, they are mixing the excess amount of cattle mineral mixtures preparations in the feed indiscriminately. That will lead to many number of copper toxins. So that you have to take care of. Whenever you are getting the history, you ask them whether they are using cattle mineral mixtures in the excess, and avoid provision of cattle feed to the sheep. And avoid the and also monitor the level of molybdenum and copper in the feed analysis. These are all the things, the simple things which will give you a very good clue for you for the prompt diagnosis for copper toxin. And here I'm not going to deal about the enterotoxemia that you will see in another occasion separately. How to approach a case of enterotoxemia and how to vaccinate, all these things are next. First, I'll show one video and we'll conclude this session. See, this is a case, just see the observe the clinical signs. The animal is having convulsions. There is no nystagmus, but see, severe convulsions is there. Pupil is very much dilated. Sometimes frothiness will be there, grinding of the teeth and the chewing of the mouth, grinding of the vigorous grinding of the teeth, and the severe convulsions will be there, diarrhea will be there. So this type of case, whenever it occurs, sudden onset, the farmer will be telling, the animal was grazing, so suddenly it is onsetting like that. Means you have to think about enterotoxemia, okay? So the animal is gasping. The animal will be having oral breathing, gasping, bloat will be there, tremors will be there. You think about cyanide poisoning. there is no bloat and all. Diarrhea is there, convulsions is there, salivation is there, severe convulsions, frothy salivation with the grinding of that. We think about enterotoxemia. So during the process of treatment itself, the animal will die. So here is one video, just is for your differential diagnosis. I left to you. See the video. Animal is in the lateral recumbency. And limbs. And naturally, everyone will be keeping in your mind the differential diagnosis of polyencephalomalacia. Very good. But that's why I'm telling, see the other video. This is not a case of polyencephalomalacia. See, that's why we should not jump into the diagnosis without clinical examination. Just by seeing the lateral recumbency, you will be seeing that it is a case of polyencephalomalacia. But see, here the neck is not bending down. The neck is stiffness. So we make the animal stand. The neck is very much stiffness is there. You cannot able to open the mouth. Locked jaw is there. It is a clear case of tetanus. Okay. So why I am insisting that clinical examination plays an important role in all the cases. So here, make the animal walk. So the animal is walking like a toy. Saw horse appearance as if it is like a toy. It is walking. Hind limb stiffness is there. Once you make the animal in the lateral recumbency, it looks like polyencephalomalacia. So this is a case of tetanus. So you treat it accordingly. So clinical examination is very, very important in case of all the cases. And thank you very much.